I'm the plain chocolate center.
I'm a southern roasted peanut, roasted to a golden tan, and drenched in milk chocolate.
Then we're both covered with thin candy shells, so there's no chocolate mess.
Play it again, Peanut.
All right.
I can't believe how square you used to be.
Me?
Oh, we chocolate!
A smile on faces big and small.
The milk chocolate melts in your mouth, not in your hand.
M&M's can still have a handful of smiles.
Six college players have won the Heisman Trophy. 160 professional players have been elected into the NFL Hall of Fame. But in the history of college and professional football, only five men have done both. One of them is Earl Christian Campbell, the Tyler Rose. Hello, I'm Ron Franklin at the Astrodome in Houston, Texas, where the ground crew right now is preparing the field for the start of another football season, and where Earl Campbell enjoyed some of his greatest athletic moments. The fifth of 11 children born to the family of Ann and B.C. Campbell of Tyler, Texas, Earl Campbell's unique running style and personal drive powered him from the farmlands of small-town Texas to the stadiums of the NFL. When Earl was 10, his family moved into a small, modest home on the north side of Tyler. Earl Campbell's father was very important to him, and the way that family is always important when you don't have much else.
All my life, I've grown up without a father. And the only somebody I've had to share all this with is a good Lord, a close friend I'd meet, like a Darrell Royal, or Lawrence McQuire, or a Corky Nelson, Fred Akers. I have never once been able to sit down, you know, to a real father and say, you know, Dad, I made it.
His daddy must have had a lot of influence on him, too. If you visit with Earl much, although he was only 10 years old when his father died, he talks about his father and how much fun he had riding in the car, just him and his father, and the things that his dad would say and do. He had a tremendous effect, too.
Ann Campbell kept a 100-acre rose field and worked as a maid to help the family along. In junior high school, Earl Campbell discovered two things that were to change his life forever. His future wife, Renee.
Love at first sight. I have to admit, there was like a little circle drive in front of Moore Junior High School, and the bus pulled up, Earl stepped off, and when I seen him, you know, it was just like a halo come over my head. That must be the guy, and we've been together ever since.
And football.
Because of his size, when Earl would get the ball, he would start running with the ball, and we had taught him to be able to use his hands real well, and he was able to push the boys off, and all that he didn't push off, he ran over. But one thing about him, he was a good sport. If he would run over someone, he would always go back to pick him up and said he's sorry, and pat him on the back, and we start out again. His ability to run, to maneuver, and to think was already developed to the point that you knew that one day that he was going to become a great star for someone.
No one could tackle Earl. He was devastating. They would grab hold to him, he would push him away. No one could tackle him at all.
I think the guy that started it all was a guy named Lawrence McQuire.
He's a guy that, you know, was with him from the ninth grade all through college, and I think that's where a lot of Earl's learnings and fatherly figure took place.
I feel like by Coach LaGuire and the other teachers talking to him and telling him what he could do and how far he could go in life is kind of what helped turn him around.
At John Tyner High School, Earl Campbell played both linebacker and running back. Campbell hoped in his early football career that, quite frankly, he would grow up to be like his idol, Chicago Bears linebacker Dick Butkus. Charles Craddock remembers Campbell's quick rise to stardom.
He played 5 ball games for me for junior varsity before the varsity coaches took him away from me. With the ball games he was having with me at the time, both offensively and defensively, they thought he would do more good with the varsity than he would do with the JVs.
In 1972, Campbell played both offense and defense. At the end of the year, the Lions had an 8-2 record, but Earl Campbell spent the last game of the year on the sidelines, disciplined for non-football infraction of high school rules. He quit the team in dispute.
Earl decided that he was going to quit the football team, and I asked him why, and he said, well, the coach wasn't right. He was treating some better than the others. So I went to the office there, and Earl was waiting on me, and I told him then, I said, now listen, boy, if you stay at John Tyler High School, you're going to have to play football. Now, if you can't play football, then we're going to have to send you home. You can't come to John Tyler High School. So the next day, he went to the coach and apologized to the coach and had the coach to call me and tell him he was back in the program. So we went from there. I'm certainly glad he went that way. I didn't know what I was going to do if he hadn't done that.
In 1973, Campbell returned to his senior year of football in the best shape of his life. The result was a season that made history. Switched by Coach Corky Nelson to full-time position as a running back, Earl Campbell brought Tyler a state championship season.
I think Earl's teammates responded very positively to his endorsement, the recognition that he received, all the publicity. And the reason he did is because Earl, as a person, handled it very well. And he would continually build up the players around him and not mention himself in personal interviews, his offensive linemen, his fullback, the way they blocked. So I think they took it very well because he used a very, I thought, smart psychological ploy, if you want to call it, or how he felt naturally and built up the players around him.
Earl Campbell combined terrific force with quickness and speed. His trademarks were jarring collisions and one of the most effective stiff arms in high school football.
I think even back then is when I started taking the attitude that I wanted more than one or two guys to bring me down. And I wanted actually to run over them. Deep down inside, I wanted to do it. I didn't want to go east and west. I wanted to go north and south. And I knew that by me being bigger than anybody, everybody else on the field, nobody really wanted to challenge that.
In the state playoffs against Plano, John Tyner won 34-0. As Earl Campbell got 219 yards on 24 carries, and he scored 3 touchdowns. In the state championship game, Campbell ran for 164 yards, and he scored 2 touchdowns against Austin Reagan. John Tyner won the game 21-14. The race to recruit Earl Campbell was on. And with good reason, Earl Campbell was an incredible performer. 2,036 yards on 309 attempts, 28 touchdowns, and an eye-popping 6.9 yards per carry average.
The first time I saw Earl was live in the state finals playing against Reagan High School. I saw him live, and then I saw him take his uniform off in the locker room. Hey, it wasn't any question after I saw that performance and I saw that physique and that muscular build and the power of it, and I saw how fleet he was and how nimble he was with his feet out there. Earl, everybody knew that he was going to be a great one. Everybody.
The honors soon poured in as Campbell became the state's most sought-after football player.
It kind of put me in the bed. I kind of got down, got sick, because I just couldn't hardly handle that. Country boy, thinking about leaving the country, going to the bright lights.
She was in the bed. She didn't feel like even sitting up to talk. I sat in a chair in there by her bed, and Earl sat on the foot of the bed.
I was a little skeptical about my house and the way it looked and everything. Me and Sheridan didn't have anything. And he sat down and told me, I believe he said that. And he said, Ann, he said, I'm going to tell you, you don't have anything to be embarrassed about. He said, because
I grew up with my grandmother, and the house that I lived in was not as nice as the one we're sitting in now.
He said, the only thing I regret, my grandmother died before I had a chance to do anything for her.
We had a very nice visit. She was extremely warm and easy to talk to. I mean, just like Earl has always been.
I certainly didn't want to see him go to Oklahoma.
More important may have been what Earl Campbell did for the recently integrated John Tyner High School.
Having Earl and such a successful football team, it really brought the whole town together. The relation there just went so good and things like that until it really made our job so easy of having the guys like that on our campus.
Tyner, Texas, however, would not be able to hold Earl Campbell. He now belonged to a much larger community.
I didn't want to be a rose farmer in Tyler, Texas, and some people that I never will forget, so he'll be back home, he'll flunk out of school. And there are certain things that happen to you in your life, you can always hear that echo. And it's like something on your shoulder, it's always bugs you.
I was able to kind of send Earl money during college. And I bought him shoes, I bought him his clothing, and sometimes he had a little bit of extra money to spend because I was the one working and I was always able to send him money. I got paid every 2 weeks and I would always send him an allowance.
I came to school here, I had one suit. My girlfriend, who's my wife now, had a suit made for me for the prom.
I had a cousin that was a seamstress and she sewed, so she made Earl's suit and my prom dress.
I think I had by two pair of Levi jeans, and one of them was cut off.
At the University of Texas, Campbell played under the great UT coaching legend, Darryl Royal, the second of the father figures to shape his life.
I think the biggest key was being coached by Darryl Royal, Fred Akers, those kind of coaches, and they was both pretty disciplined. And you had to do a lot of hard work to prove yourself to them. I mean, one touchdown to them wasn't good enough. They wanted more. Four first downs wasn't good enough. They wanted more. And I knew that, and I took that kind of attitude that I can do better.
Campbell powered his way into the starting lineup as a freshman. In fact, in his first game, he gained 85 yards on 13 carries for a 6.5 yard per carry average. For opponents, it was a potent indication of Campbell's future. Campbell's first really big game was against Washington, and it brought 125 yards on 16 carries. He ended his first year with three more 100-yard games. One of Campbell's now legendary football feats was performed in his freshman year against Frank Royal's Arkansas Razorbacks.
But as I recall it, we had about 2 minutes left in the half, and we held Arkansas, and they were going to punt, and Mike Campbell had been working with Earl rushing the punter.
Coach Campbell said, okay, it's time, go block the punt. And I ran out on the field, you know, and I got in a three-point stance right between the guard and the center. And that running back, sure enough, looked at me. And when he turned his head, I went right by him. And I just jumped up, you know, like you're supposed to block a punt. Sure enough, I blocked it.
Doug English takes it in for the touchdown. We kick off and hold him three more downs. And we had him out there to block it again, but he didn't get this one blocked. But we did get the ball back. And as soon as we got the ball back, he broke for 60. So we go into the locker room. There in 2 minutes, just boom, boom, two touchdowns up. And we had an easy time the rest of the day. I mean, it just kind of killed him. We had a heck of a ball game going until he blocked that punt. It was nip and tuck.
When Texas ended the year at 8-3, Campbell had eye-opening numbers for a freshman. 928 yards on 162 carries for a 5.7 yards per carry average and throw in six touchdowns for good measure. Texas finished 9-2 in Campbell's sophomore year, capping the season with a 38-21 win over Colorado. And that was played here in Houston at the Bluebonnet Bowl. He ended his sophomore season with 1,118 yards on 198 carries, 13 touchdowns, and All-American recognition. Behind the public acclaim for Earl Campbell There was, however, a very private agony that the star faced.
I used to sit on the steps at Jester, the dorm, and I used to always kind of cry inside because I couldn't go anywhere. I didn't have any money after playing in front of 60,000-70,000 students in such a great stadium. I would go back to the dorm along with some other guys, you know, that didn't have anything. It was lonely.
Just as important as football was Earl Campbell's desire to succeed in the classroom.
One of the reasons was I wasn't an A student like a lot of people at the university or a B student. So what I said is, I said, you know, out of all the people in that class, that professor gonna know when I'm there and when I'm not there because I'm bigger than most of those people. So what I would do was I'd go sit right on the front row.
And he would not miss a class. He got up every day. He used to go down through the dormitory waking guys up that had early classes, say, hey, get out of that sack. It's time to go to class. He was actually kind of like a proctor and an assistant coach being in the dormitory. But he would not cut classes.
He was like an alarm clock for several of them. He was never late with it. He'd go bang on those doors. He'd get them up. He'd go to class. He took a crowd with him every day. He was a leader.
Bob Book wanted me to come out to California to film his show, and I said I can't because I got a test. And I knew if I had missed that test, I might have made a bad grade, and that would have put me a few hours back from getting my degree, and I said, adios.
A lot of the guys would just say, I'm gone. They'd be gone a week and miss a whole week of classes. Earl wouldn't even miss a day. He wouldn't miss one class to go be on the Bob Hope show, and they were sending the jet for him.
The junior year was Campbell's most difficult year in college. Despite entering the year with high hopes and in excellent condition at 245 pounds, Campbell's high-powered running attack ground to a halt. One week, for instance, he would gain 208 yards against a North Texas State team. The next week, 91 against Oklahoma, but only 57 against a so-so SMU team, 65 yards against Texas Tech. And that convinced UT's head coach Daryl Royal that Campbell needed a rest to recover from a hamstring injury, one that some said potentially could have been career-ending.
We had a bad year, but we never lost a game that Earl Campbell played in. The only time we lost was when he was sitting on the bench with pulled hamstrings. And I believe if he had been well, had he not been hurt, we would have been in a major bowl.
Campbell returned for the last game of the year with a 131-yard performance against Texas A&M. But Texas ended the 76th season with a mediocre 5-5-1 record. Earl Campbell's statistics for the year were not of All-American caliber. 653 yards on 138 carries. That was for a 4.7 yard per carry average. Campbell's football career was on hold, but he was maturing as a young man. And at the center of his circle of friends was none other than Daryl Royal.
He used to come ring the doorbell when he was playing and come by the house, visit with Edith and me. And sometimes he'd lay down on the floor, sometimes he'd stretch out on the couch, just visit, 15, 20 minutes, maybe half an hour. And he'd say, well, coach, I just came by to say hi. Just wanted to visit with you a little bit. So he made an effort to be a friend.
I think the thing that helped us out more than anything is that we had a relationship, but the one thing we had in common that all the guys on the team didn't have is that we were both lovers of country music.
We were good friends from the moment we met, and it's one of those things that's never changed. I like him, he likes me, I respect him, he respects me. We have good times together. We don't have to be together, you know, all the time. I see him a couple of times a year, and that's plenty. Many times I've turned around and there was Earl Campbell singing on the stage with me, and it was a thrill every time, and always a surprise. Sometimes he sings different registers than other nights, and that's tricky, you know, but it takes a professional vocalist to do that. He is a legitimate singer. Now, what degree of, how really good he is, that will never be truly known.
Well, if I do it my way, what is since Wood is not here? Well, I should have gone fishing. I got to thinking it over. The road to the river is a mighty long way. And if Murray was here, he'd say, a mighty long way.
let me put it this way. If he and Chris Christopherson did an album together, Chris would get raves.
In 1977, the scene changed to Texas. Daryl Royal moved up to a position as athletic director, and Fred Akers returned to Texas to become their head coach.
I was not Daryl Royal. I was not there to replace Daryl in any way. I succeeded him, and now it's Fred Akers' turn. I'm going to be Fred Akers. And Earl is going to need to adjust to me, and he did.
Campbell, at Akers' suggestion, dropped 20 pounds and reported for the fall season at 225.
I weighed like 245, I think, and I never will forget this. Fred Akers called me in his office, and I knew Coach Akers from my freshman year because he was a running back coach. And he calls me in, and this guy, you got to understand Coach Akers. I mean, he gets right in your face, and he's looking at you. He says, do you want to run the football next year? I said, yes, sir. He said, okay, you know what I formation is? I said, yeah, I think I've seen it a couple of times. He said, I'm going to tell you something. You go all the way down to 225 pounds because you're going to be the man next year. You're going to carry the ball about 35 times a game. I said, is that right? He said, yeah, I'm going to make Ham Jones the fullback, and you're going to be the halfback. You understand that? So I immediately got with Frank Medina, and I would work out with Frank. My days would start back then, 5:30, 6 o'clock in the morning.
Once Earl went to Frank, and he said, you know, I want to do this, then Frank was relentless.
It would be dark, and I would be running around the stadium, 200 or 300 sit-ups before class, punching bag. Then he'd throw me in the steam room.
Earl would work with him early in the morning, work all day, and then come back and work with the other players in the afternoon. And I was afraid he was going to get burned out because he was really, really taxing himself physically.
I think that the thing that Frank Medina taught me above everything, that if you want something and you really, really want it bad enough, you'll do anything.
That year, 1977, turned into a legendary season for Earl Campbell and the Texas Longhorns.
I knew that I needed to get into a two-back offense, and there aren't many options when you make that decision. And we ran the split back veer and the I formation, and the I mainly because of Earl Campbell.
In UT's opening game against Boston College, Campbell got 87 yards on 17 carries, and he scored a touchdown, as UT won easily 44-0. In the second game, UT blew out Virginia 68-0 as Campbell produced 156 yards on 19 carries. The trend continued against Rice, with UT winning 72-15. Campbell, 131 yards on 13 carries and 4 touchdowns. The fourth game against bitter rival Oklahoma saw Campbell deliver 100 yards again as UT won 13-6.
Steve Hall trapped that defensive back somehow. I mean, he was so big, too. I just think he just kind of laid on the guy like this. And here I came and I saw it, and I remember hurling over the guy and ran into the end zone. What a high that was. And I just kind of sit the ball down and walked off like always. But I deep down inside, I was so happy. It was unbelievable.
In the fifth game of the year, Texas defeated Arkansas 13-9 as the Tyler Rose notched another superior performance.
The run that he made against Arkansas on the little screen pass that we threw to him, you can call it a pass, but it was behind the line of scrimmage, and then he made a heck of a run to win the ball game.
Fred Akers has enough confidence in me. Clock's running out. Randy McKeachin's the quarterback. He threw me in that screen pass. I swore I was in the end zone before my knees hit, but I knew I saw one guy in front of me in the end zone. So what I figured I'd do to him was lower my head and run over him, but the ref said my knee went down. And I remember sticking that ball over there in the end zone.
Now, Campbell, sensing a very special year, began to thunder. against SMU, the sixth game of the year. UT won 30-14 as Campbell burned the Ponies for 213 yards and one touchdown. The seventh game pitted Texas against Texas Tech. Final score, the Longhorns 26, the Red Raiders nothing. As Earl Campbell again rushed for over 100 yards. Campbell had another highlight film against the University of Houston, rushing for 173 yards and three touchdowns as UT won 35-21.
The thing that I will always remember about that Houston game is the night before when we started our team meeting, Earl couldn't make it. He was sick. He had 104 temperature. I mean, he was vomiting. He couldn't keep anything on his stomach. We put him to bed. And the next morning, the first thing I did was get and check on Earl. And he still had a temperature. He was still feeling weak. And I thought, good gracious, what a time to have to go without a guy like Earl.
I think that's the game that Fred Akers really made up in his mind that I'm going to just let it all hang out. I'm going to give it to him, just see how much he can stand.
All he did that day was gain 190 yards rushing, and he was weak, but he wanted that game. He really wanted it.
I think in the south end zone, on my third touchdown, I ran down on my knees and I said, thank God. And I think I did like that when it was all over. I dropped, sit the ball down and got down and said, thank God, and walked off. I think to this day in 1991, I am the only one that ever knocked Bevo down. And I think I did it during that game.
He did run into Bevo in the end zone. That's right, in Rice Stadium.
Against TCU in the ninth game of the year, Campbell rushed for 153 yards and scored two touchdowns. Texas won 44-14. 10th game of the year, UT 29, Baylor 7. Campbell, 181 yards on 32 carries, one touchdown. In his final regular season game as a Longhorn, Campbell delivered what has to be considered a classic performance against the Aggies. Carrying for 228 yards, he scored four touchdowns as Texas defeated A&M 57-28.
Coming down the tunnel, Fred Akers walked over. He said, you know, you want to win the Heisman Trophy? I said, yeah. He said, I tell you what you do. You give me something over 100 yards and you'll win it.
We told Earl that he's going to have to handle the ball 30 times in that ball game, and that each 30 need to be his best of the year. He doesn't need to leave there with anyone in the stands not singing his praises. That if he wins this ball game, he'll win the Heisman Trophy.
Every time I got that ball in my hand, I thought about what he told me coming on to that field. You give me 100 yards and you'll do it.
You know, Earl's the kind of guy that you forget about as a receiver.
That was my nickname, Brick Hands, or Brick House or something. So in that game against A&M, we had kind of been working during the week on this. It's kind of like a flare route to the left. Except for I was the guy that was going to be catching the ball and doing the flare.
It was a pass, believe it or not, that we'd thrown several times in practice, but never in a game.
But Randy McKeachin was going to take the ball in the other offense and roll over to their right. Well, for some reason, all those A&M people thought they should go over there. And I was just standing over there all by myself. And McKeachin said that he swore that he seen every inch of my eyes get that big, saying, I don't know. He said, just don't drop it, just catch it. And I got it, and I just ran all the way on the left side all by myself.
It just broke the whole stadium. I mean, it got deathly quiet around there when he hit that seam up that sideline. No one expected him to do it.
Earl Campbell produced 1,744 yards on 267 carries, and that's an average per try of 6.5 yards. Also add 19 touchdowns. Those numbers were good enough for Campbell to lead the nation in both rushing and scoring. Total UT stats for the Tyner Rose, 4,443 yards on 765 carries for a 5.8 yards per carry average. The honors were soon incoming. Top runner in Southwest Conference history, top rusher in Texas history, nominated for the Heisman Trophy. Could it be that the Tyner Rose would win the Heisman Trophy?
Earl called me one night and said to me, he said, Mama, he said, you know this thing about the Heisman Trophy, said, they're talking to me about the Heisman, and said, I never had no idea, had no thoughts about no Heisman Trophy. Says, I just been playing ball and have been doing the things I supposed to do to the best of my ability. He said, but I never had any idea about winning a Heisman Trophy.
At first, I thought it was just another award. I thought it was just something that everybody's gonna know. What's this big deal about the Heisman Trophy, you know? And I don't think I understood it until I really got there and started reading who all's name was on the trophy in the lobby of the downtown athletic club. And then I said, you know, my name's gonna be printed on that one day.
The Heisman Trophy, and it goes to Earl Campbell of the University of Texas.
You know, when I was a kid and I'd get in trouble, I'd always say, hey, Mom, I'm in trouble, you know? So, Mom, I'm in trouble. I don't have anything to say. Took a lot of hard work. And I really just can't say thanks to just one person because there's so many people included in it. But I will represent what a Heisman Trophy winner should be. Thank you very much.
Campbell was a cinch to be the first player picked in the 1978 draft. But Tampa Bay, not the Houston Oilers, owned the rights to the first pick.
Well, Earl Campbell was in a class by himself. You didn't have to have a high IQ to understand that he was one of the, was going to be an impact player in the National Football League. And you know, from the very beginning, I was trying to figure out how am I going to get Earl Campbell. We won't be in last place, but maybe it'd be worth being last place to get to draft him first.
I think it's important to know something about a guy, not just how fast he runs or how big he is and all. I think it's important to know what kind of kid you're talking about. And I called Earl and asked him about him, because that was what I was really interested in. I knew he could play football. I didn't know what kind of kid he was.
We were fortunate enough to make a trade for Earl, which probably Mr. Culverhouse, who just gotten the Tampa Bay franchise. We talked back and forth. He had the first choice coming up. He said, Bud, I know Earl went to school in Texas, and he's Tyler's Rose and all that sort of thing. He said, but we need a football player. And I said, but think what it mean for Houston and the franchise and everything like that. He made the trade. His coach didn't want to make the trade, but he said, I think he ought to stay in Texas. And we sent Jimmy Giles and a number one draft choice, traded our number one draft choice with him. So that I think if Hugh Culverhouse had that do-over, he would never have done it the second time around.
The match between the country Coach Phillips and the country boy Earl Campbell was perfect. In Phillips, Campbell found a new father figure in his life, and a man who totally believed in Earl Campbell, not only as a player, but as a human being.
What can I say about Bum? He and Earl have a very close relationship.
He'll come to my house and spend the night with me, or I'll go to Austin and spend the night with him. And we go around and mess around just like guys the same age, you know. Age don't make any difference to friends. Friendship, I think, surpasses age.
Campbell came into camp as a high-priced rookie. Like all rookies, he had to prove himself to the veterans.
I thought we'd screwed up. And this guy's running in there and he got his eyes closed. That's what I thought. And then I thought that for two or three games or an exhibition game season. And finally, I think the fourth preseason game, it started coming together for him.
I guess because of all the other disappointments in the years past, it was just I guess in the long run, it would just be another year. But not knowing what that this guy could come in and change and help change, turn this whole program around.
In coaching, you try to find what you call athletic ability. And we had a little test that we'd run them through, agility tests and stuff like that. And we had some little cones and had them set up in a square. And you run around the first one this way, and then you get to the second one, you back around it. Well, every time he'd go backwards, he'd fall right flat of his back. And the Bourgeois come in and said, "Coach, I'm telling you, every time Earl tries to back up, he falls down." I said, "Well, we didn't draft him to back up. We drafted him to go forward."
Earl really was not that agile. If you watch him doing little drills, but during the game, he had an unbelievable ability to withstand hits and keep his balance, and he was very agile. You know, I seen him make cuts during the game he couldn't do during the practice. He'd fall down on his face, you'd say, "Who is this guy?" But during the games, I mean, he would just turn into a different type of person.
When we practiced, we'd have dummy practice, you know, and I'm telling you, he'd run up the back of Carl and just, you know, our call said, "You watch out, when them little feet start going, that means he's right on your back and you ain't got no place to go."
And let me tell you something, when you heard that train coming, you try to get off the track.
I really was worried about him a little bit. We went up to scrimmage, Kansas City, you know, and he looked average, you know. He didn't look like the back that he was. That was all rookies, you know. All the rookies went up there and he didn't know the plays, didn't know what to do, didn't know what to run. And he looked kind of average up there. But by the time the veterans got in, and he found out where to go, look out.
On September the 3rd, 1978, in his first game as a Houston Oiler, Campbell took a lateral from Dan Pastorini and went 73 yards for a touchdown. He finished his first game as a pro with 137 yards on 15 carries.
I think with his acquisition, his come in and starting in that game, overall, we felt that we never could have confidence in the offense. All we had to do was just get the ball for the offense. And in the long run, it paid off.
He was the type of runner, the more he carried the ball, the better he got, the stronger he got, the hungrier he got. And that is what you want to do. You want to wear down the opposition.
We were running the same plays before we got Earl, but they looked a lot different. Everybody got to asking me, "How'd you run that play?" You know, I didn't run it at all. Just hand it to Earl, let him run it.
He just captured the attention of the whole country. I remember his run, I think, on a Monday night football game. Just tremendous.
The one that I always pick out that stands out in my mind as the most exciting and maybe the purest game of football was a November night in Houston back in 1978. Bob Greasy was a quarterback of the Miami Dolphins, and Earl Campbell was the rookie running back for Houston. And it was a seesaw game that went back and forth, and Love You Blue was born that night. And I don't think I've ever heard a crowd get into a game quite like that. And Howard Cosell and I were doing that game by ourselves. And I remember talking to him during a timeout in the third quarter, and I said, "We may never have another one like this." And, of course, that was leading up to the climax when Houston needed a touchdown to make sure that Greasy couldn't bring the Dolphins back one more time. And he went off tackle, broke it to the outside, and he went 80 yards for a touchdown. And that really locked it up. And it was a 200-yard night for Earl Campbell. And I think maybe the most amazing part of that run was the fact it was his 28th carry for the night.
I mean, he had that something within him and that just made him special. I mean, it's uncanny. In the huddle, Earl was totally out of breath. I almost called timeout because I thought there's no way this guy could run the ball again. I mean, I came within inches of calling timeout because his head's down. He didn't hear the play.
The thing that made my life go from just a regular halfback or a running back to up in the class with the Jim Browns and Walter Payton when I put that long run out there, that 79-yarder, and Howard Cosell blowed it up for to the day he got off there. And I'll always be grateful for him for that.
I always thought that game was the best game we ever had on Monday Night Football. I'll never forget the way it evolved. Final score, of course, was Houston 35, Miami 31. The real story of the game was Earl Campbell. Earl Campbell showed that night that he was one of the great running backs of the National Football League. Not just then, not just that game, not just that year, but for all time. Campbell ran for over 200 yards that night, and he broke tackle after tackle. They just couldn't down him. After all, he was proving to the whole world why he had won, and deservedly so, the Heisman Trophy. He was proving to the whole world that no single tackler could bring him down. He was pure football. And the great thing about Earl Campbell was that he was pure football off the field, that he was a fine human being, and that he cared about people. And that's why Earl always meant so much to me. But I'll never forget, that was when we introduced the song, and there was always an argument over where the song originated. Miami claimed it, and Houston claimed it. I always felt that Houston had the proper claim. But the song went, if you'll remember, Houston has the Oilers. They're the greatest football team. They take the ball from goal to goal. They're the best you've ever seen. Houston Oilers. Houston Oilers. Houston Oilers, number one. Love ya, Blue. And that was the birth of Love Ya, Blue. It was a great evening, and I'll never forget it.
By the end of his first year as a pro, Earl Campbell had gained 1,450 yards on 302 attempts. He had scored 13 touchdowns and averaged 4.6 yards a carry. He won the league rushing title, the Rookie of the Year Award, and the Most Valuable Player Award. The Oilers marched through the playoffs and into the AFC Championship game against the Pittsburgh Steelers. The Steelers prevailed in the championship game, but the Houston-Pittsburgh rivalry had become football's hottest.
They just were obsessed with trying to beat our butt.
They were our arch rivals in a sense at that time. There was no question about that, and Earl was their biggest weapon.
They were a great football team. And they had, you know, they were a tough football team, and our football team was a tough team. And they respected our football team because of that, and especially Earl, you know, because they had so much hell with him. You know, he's a dominating player.
I can speak from firsthand experience. Earl was 235, and at the time when I was playing, probably 270, 275. And he would hurt me.
The loss to the Steelers did not change the way the city of Houston felt about its team. Over 50,000 fans greeted the team when it arrived at the Astrodome.
Well, obviously those people that showed up in 1978 and 79 that lined the freeway, I-45 from Intercontinental Airport all through the parking lot of the Astrodome. And inside the Astrodome, we were inside the lead limousine, and you couldn't hear us talk inside that car. The noise was so loud. I'll never forget that. I remember that like it was yesterday. And when you see footage on that, I get choked up. I love that team.
The season over, Campbell continued to grow. Off the field, he remained a country boy, typically straightforward, honest, and still a little bashful.
Mama, don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys. Don't let them pick guitars and drive them old trucks. Make them be doctors and lawyers and such.
Mama, don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys. They'll never stay home and they're always alone, even with someone they love. Mama, don't let your babies grow up.
The 1979 season opened for the Houston Oilers with great anticipation. Phillips' team was composed of walk-ons, free agents, some high-priced talent, and led by the gutsy quarterback Dante Pastorini and the quiet, hard-working Earl Campbell.
I saw him make a 9-yard run against the Washington Redskins, and 7 people hit him in a 9-yard run, scoring run. They come up and hit him right in the thigh, you know, and just go, like pouring a glass of water on your leg. You just run right down it. Just kept on going.
By midseason, the Oilers were a devastating team to play.
on the road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again. The life I love is making music with my friends. And I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again. Going places that I've never been. Seeing things that I may never see again. I can't wait to get on the road again.
Playing the Dallas Cowboys on Thanksgiving Day in a nationally televised game, Houston came back from a 21-17 deficit at halftime to win 30-24. Campbell gained 195 yards on 33 carries and scored 2 touchdowns. Now the stage was set for another classic confrontation with the Steelers. On Monday, December the 10th, before a Monday Night Football audience, the Oilers and Steelers collided again, this time in the Astrodome.
We used to have a play called a sucker play, and it was against Pittsburgh. Because Joe Green, we couldn't, a lot of times, the way he used to line up, we had a hard time blocking him. When we ran our sweeps, he would, you know, kind of get a lot of penetration because we couldn't get the guard or center on him because of the way we lined up. So they had this sucker play where the guard would pull and Joe would automatically follow him. But see, the thing was that they had me lead on Joe. Now, that play worked good first time and the second time. Then after the second time, I remember Joe saying, listen, hey, Wilson, you run that play one more time, I'm going to kill you. You know, and I'm going to tell you what, it's pretty tough for a fullback blocking these defensive linemen on a regular basis. I remember telling Coach Bond, I said, Bond, I think we better go to something else. We didn't run that play enough.
I think Joe was no doubt the leader of that whole Pittsburgh Steelers team. And it's no doubt in my mind when we played against Pittsburgh, I tried to pump it up another notch because I knew I was playing against the best in the whole league as far as I'm concerned. And I think if they were sitting there and had to be honest about it, they even pumped it up another notch.
As a competitor, I always wanted to face the best that any team had to offer. When the best don't meet the best, everyone gets cheated. But my philosophy changed that day.
In a bitter and brutal struggle, the Oilers won 20-17, with Campbell gaining 109 yards. At the game, the Oilers unveiled the Love You Blue slogan that became the team's trademark for the 70s.
Houston was just, I don't know, it was a right time and a right group of kids, and it was the right fans mixture. Everything went together, you know. Our fans were as proud of our players as our players were of our fans. You know, it was a two-way street.
Campbell was again the most valuable player in the league. Again, the league leader in rushing. Mr. Consistency was building the legend. By the end of his second season, defensive players around the league knew all too well about Earl Campbell's running style. He was now being compared to the great Jim Brown. Brown and Campbell were similar in that both men were big, strong, and fast.
He didn't run like a fast guy run. You know, fast guy run real smooth, but Earl was fast, but he is football fast.
It's another level. I mean, the man is a genetic freak as far as I'm concerned. You know, a player like him comes along once in a century.
Earl broke through the left side of the line. He was running for a touchdown. And I don't know if I've ever seen this before in athletics, but Earl actually slowed down, waiting for Plank and waiting for Fensick to catch up to him. And as soon as they got there, Earl, with his tremendous strength, with his right arm, gave him what we used to refer to as the bone.
A guy like Earl, you just don't think would have that kind of speed. But he had this explosiveness about him. I mean, my God, his legs were, 36-inch thighs? I think he was more deceptive to people. People just didn't really think that he was that fast.
Campbell's north-south running style was built around a simple strategy. Go directly at the opponent. The result was a career of collisions on the football field that are now NFL legend. Like this head-on blast against Ram linebacker Isaiah Robertson.
hit him up in the belly with his head, just bowled him over. Oh, and then just run down the field with that ball like a loaf of bread, jersey half ripped off and shoving people out of the way. And they'd try to hit him on his leg and they'd bounce off, you know. He's a pleasure to watch run.
Jack Tatum, the feared defensive back of the Oakland Raiders, was on the receiving end of perhaps Earl Campbell's greatest hit.
I don't know how either one of them lived. It sounded like a train wreck. I was down the goal line, and, you know, 2 or 3 yards to go. And it was an off-tackle play, but it wound up going way outside because they jammed it up pretty good. And Tatum came up and popped him, knocked him back. It was the first and only time I've ever seen Earl really knocked off balance by one person and be stunned. And Tatum just hit him. They both hit head on. And Tatum just sat in the ground and couldn't move. I mean, he was just dazed. He had a glazed look on his face like, I'm sure, one of George Foreman's former opponents. And Earl just kind of stumbled into the end zone. How he got into the end zone, I don't know. But I've never seen or heard an impact in my life. It sounded like a train wreck. It really did. It sounded like two cars just hitting head on.
In 1980, Campbell had his greatest year as a pro. He gained 206 yards rushing against the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. That's the team that almost had drafted him. 1 week later against Cincinnati, Campbell again gained over 200 yards, tying the NFL record for the most consecutive 200-yard games. By the year's end, Campbell had gained 1,934 yards on 373 carries for a 5.2 yard per carry average and 13 touchdowns. Once again, he led the league in rushing and again was the most valuable player. Earl Campbell played 5 more seasons of professional football. 3.5 with the Oilers, 1.5 with the New Orleans Saints. His career numbers were simply astounding. 9,407 yards on 2,187 attempts. That's a 4.3 yards per carry average. And he scored 74 touchdowns. In 1986, the Tyra Rose retired. The professional years behind him, Earl Campbell has now turned his attention to new challenges.
For some reason, a football camp entered my mind, and I came back to the hotel and started talking to a couple of friends about it. Just took off from there.
Campbell approaches each element in his life with the same determination and desire that he once showed on the football field.
Christian understands when he gets here, he goes to the University of Texas. Tyler, we're trying to teach him that.
We're very pleased to have Earl on campus, of course, on a daily basis. He brings a lot to the university. He works with the minority kids. I think he makes people understand that, you know, if you do work hard and you do perform well academically, you will be a success.
On July the 27th, 1991, Earl Campbell's football career took the final step up the ladder of success. He was inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame.
I'd like to take credit for Earl Campbell and for all he's meant to football, but truth about it, the credit belongs to the other people that raised him. His junior high coaches, his college coaches, his mama Ann, his sister, and his whole family. They're the ones that did the job. Believe me, when I got Earl Campbell, he was not only a football player already, he knew how to live on the field and off the field. And it's a credit to his family and the people that have brought him up. Every time you see Earl Campbell sign an autograph, you'll see him sign it, and he'll look up and he'll look you in the eye and he'll ask you your name, and he'll take time with you and make sure that you understand that he's as proud you ask him as he is to sign it. Believe me, those are the things that I think about Earl Campbell. Y'all can watch him in the movies, I can watch him in my memory. I've got a lot of memories, been around a long time. I think about it a lot. when I stop and think about it, Earl Campbell, you are my greatest memory of all. I'd like to introduce to you all my personal friend, a guy that you're gonna get to hear talk, and he ain't gonna talk near as long as I did. The Tyler Rose from Tyler, Texas, Earl Christian Campbell.
Every team I've ever played on, I've always tried to share with the guys that I play with. And I think if any of them ever had anything to say about Earl Campbell, they'd say he's a giver, he's not a taker. And there goes my mother, Mrs. Ann Campbell. I was listening to her coming back from the hall the other day, was going to the hotel. She had 7 boys and 4 girls. I'm number 6 in the family. I said, you know, everything is great. It's amazing how God blesses you. She says, yes. So I remember one Sunday morning, I was getting y'all dressed for church. I told your daddy, I said, I won't ever get to go anywhere. I won't ever get a chance to see anything. He says, darling, you ought to be careful. You never know what God got in store for you. She said, who'd have thought I'd be here in Canton, Ohio? I didn't even think I was going to be here, Mama. But I'm happy you're here. The more and more I try to write a speech, the one thing I'll always remember about this day, beyond football, is that my daddy, B.C. Campbell, is up there in heaven, I believe, with all his buddies. And he's telling them what a great son he had. Look at my son, I know he can handle it. And I thank you all so much for everything. And every day is not a great day in my life. I mean, I'm like everybody else. I work hard, and that's all I ever do. I got a lady been with me, I think, 24 years, if I'm right. You stay with them so long, you kind of forget it. But if it was me, some days I'd just say, Earl, I'm through with you, son. But she reminds me of a song that Willie Nelson, Merle Haggard wrote called Oh, Tougher Than Leather. That's my wife, Renee. I'm so proud to be an American. I'm so proud to be in the Hall of Fame with the Jim Browns, the Franco Harris, and someday soon, I'm sure, the Walter Paytons and Dorsett. But when they say Campbell, I want y'all to remember this. The old boy gave it his all. Who are by my memories, as Willie Nelson say, thank you.
Ash that sprinkled the blue. Few old dreams that I can't use. Who'll buy my memories of things that used to be? There were the smiles before the tears. And with a smile, some better years. Who'll buy my memories of things that used to be? When I remember how things were, my memories all lead to her. I'd like to start my life anew, but memories just make me blue. A cottage small, just built for two. A garden wall with violets blue. Who'll buy my memories of things that used to be?